Scientists accidentally stumbled upon a leak in the ocean floor that could potentially induce the final release of the long-feared Big One, a horrifying magnitude 9 earthquake that could wipe out most of the northwestern coast of the US and parts of Canada's British Columbia. I'm talking about a unique sea pole in the Pacific Ocean seafloor that is gushing out almost fresh water at a higher rate than ever recorded. Water that acts as a lubricant between the two tectonic plates colliding in the Cascadia subduction zone off the coast of Newport, Oregon. Many are freaking out thinking that this will unleash Armageddon, but does this really represent the risk many fear? And most importantly, how will or should this discovery change your everyday life if you live on the west coast of California? As you can imagine, it's really important to me. I live in San Diego. So let's find out together. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by Delete Me. Okay, so this is a very interesting story, and it got many people I know a bit nervous, and I thought it was worth doing a little bit of research to see exactly what's going on and why there's all this talk about an imminent megaquake off the coast of Oregon. I'll start with how the news broke. A few months ago, on January 2023, Brendan Phillip and a team of marine geologists and geophysicists from the University of Washington published a paper in Science Advances about a high-flux seafloor seep within the central Cascadia subduction zone. Bear with me a little bit. I know it's a mouthful, but we'll explain all that in just a bit. The seep was originally discovered by accident in 2015 by Phillip when he and another team of researchers were held back from going far out to sea because of bad weather and ended up exploring the seafloor about 50 miles off the coast of Oregon. They happened to notice a plume of bubbles emerging from the seafloor about 0.6 miles below the water's surface. So they decided to check it out and sent an unmanned submarine for a closer view. Apart from bubbles, later confirmed to be methane, they discovered a series of holes that were gushing out warm water. I mean, there was and still is water coming out of the ground and into the ocean instead of the other way around. Normally, this wouldn't have attracted that much attention since seeps of water into the ocean at fault lines is relatively common. What surprised them was how fast water was pouring out. I mean, you can actually see the flow of water in the video footage. They called the site Pythia's Oasis, and after years of studying the seep's chemistry and analyzing surrounding geological data, they finally published their findings, and their conclusions shocked the world. Before we get into that, let's talk about our sponsor this week, Delete Me. Delete Me is a hands-free subscription service that will remove your personal information that's being sold online. Delete Me's privacy experts remove you from Google and 100+ data brokers all year long. Get a privacy report in 7 days. Remove all your personal information like phone and address. Monitor sites and repeat removal as needed, and users can even make custom removal requests. I've been a member now for almost 6 months, and I just got my second quarterly report. Staying private online is an ongoing battle. Just look at all the places Delete Me has removed my data and where it's in progress. Truly amazing, and something none of us spend nearly enough time thinking about. With Delete Me, you don't have to. Let their team of experts scour the web and keep your personally identifiable information private. So stay a step ahead of your privacy online and save 20% on all plans with code Ricky with Delete Me. Links in description. Huge thanks to Delete Me and you for supporting the show. To understand why, we have to give a little bit of context, and that means talking about earthquakes and faults. If you remember your earth science class from high school, you'll recall that you can think of the Earth's crust as a gigantic puzzle made up of large pieces called tectonic plates. These plates are consistently moving and interacting with each other, and sometimes they can create cracks or fractures. These cracks or fractures are what we call tectonic faults, and they're important because that's where most of the earthquakes in the world come from. The Cascadia subduction zone houses a particularly deadly type of fault. You see, there are three different types of faults that can form as these plates move around: normal, reverse, and strike slip faults. A normal fault forms at the boundary of two plates as they're pulling away from each other. Reverse faults are the opposite. They form when two plates collide and compress against one another head on, with one of the plates sliding up and over the other, which dips into the Earth's mantle. Finally, we have strike slip faults, which are when plates slide horizontally past each other, moving in opposite directions. When plates rub against each other, they can sometimes get stuck because of friction. But since the massive plates keep moving with respect to each other, this creates tension at the boundary, like compressing a spring. Eventually, the fault slips and the whole thing moves suddenly in one huge thrust, unleashing all the accumulated energy and producing an earthquake. It's kind of like when you try to slide a wet finger over clean glass. It kind of sticks at first and then slides all at once. Of the three types, reverse faults are by far the most deadly. The Cascadia subduction zone is an example of a special type of reverse fault called a megathrust, which is the deadliest kind there is. The fault stretches 600 to 700 miles between the massive North American tectonic plate and the Juan de Fuca plate, and it runs from the Cape Mendocino in Northern California to Vancouver Island in British Columbia. In the CSZ, the oceanic plate called the Juan de Fuca plate is being pushed underneath the continental North American plate. When these plates lock or stick to each other, it causes the overlying plate, here that's the North American plate, to buckle and deform. This deformation can lead to the buildup of energy, which is eventually released as a devastating earthquake. We used to think that the Cascadia subduction zone was a silent or aseismic fault because there was no record of any earthquake or other activity happening there. However, geologist Ruth Ludwin from the University of Washington discovered in the mid-80s that it was simply in a quiet phase. After digging a little deeper and looking at local tales from Native North Americans in the area, he noticed there was a recurring myth centered around the year 1700, where completely unrelated tribes had remarkably similar accounts of a cataclysmic event that shook the earth and flooded the land, killing almost everyone near the shore. He then discovered written records from Japan of a completely unannounced tsunami that hit on the night of January 26th, 1700. That tsunami, which obliterated entire towns in Japan, was the orphan wave of the last Circadian megathrust earthquake of an estimated 9.0 or more on the Richter scale. And geologists quickly caught on to what this meant. This massive megathrust fault is just currently dormant. So they set out to find out more about its seismic history. What they found was even more unsettling. Geographic records showed that over the last 10,000 years, there have been not one but 41 megathrust quakes in Cascadia, almost all of them above 8 points on the Richter scale, and at least 5 to 7 of them on a strength of 9 or more. If you already did the math, then you know what this means. This quake happens on average every 240 to 250 years, and the last one was 323 years ago. Cascadia is 73 years overdue for a megathrust earthquake. Scientists estimate a 1 in 3 chance of it happening in the next 50 years, and it's almost sure to happen before the next 100 to 150 years, since in 10,000 years of history, the longest period without a Cascadia megaquake has been around 500 years. So what does that have to do with Pythia's oasis? Now that we know the context and the danger that the ZSE represents to the entire West Coast of the US and Canada, we can do a rundown on Philip and his coworkers' paper. There were three things that stood out from the water seeping out at Pythia's oasis. One, the amount of water pouring out. Two, the water's chemical composition. And three, the water's temperature. The group of scientists measured water coming out at a flow rate of about 4 to 12 inches per second, 10 to 30 centimeters per second. Now this doesn't seem huge, but it actually is, with news outlets comparing it to a fire hose. You see, the maximum recorded flow rates of water seeping out of the seafloor elsewhere in the region has been around 4 to 40,000 inches per year, compared to about 1.2 to 3.5 times 10 to the 8 inches per year observed at Pythia's oasis. So we're talking about water gushing out 3 to 9,000 times faster than the highest flow rates ever recorded to date. The hole itself is about 2 inches wide. So at that rate, it adds about 3.2 to 9.5 gallons per minute. A small 1.75 foot fire hose like the ones firemen go into burning buildings with puts out about 120 to 180 gallons per minute, or 2 to 3 gallons per second. So Pythia's oasis certainly isn't gushing like a fire hose of water, but perhaps a garden hose. The second thing that caught the researchers' attention was the water's chemical composition, which is at least 62% less salty than the surrounding water. So it wasn't exactly seawater gushing out. It was a mixture of seawater and freshwater. Finally, there was the water's temperature of around 53.6 degrees Fahrenheit or 12 degrees Celsius, a little over 16 degrees warmer than the surrounding 37.4 degree water of the Pacific. What geologists inferred from the unusually high flow rate, high temperatures, and low salt content was that there must be a very high pressure fluid in the boundary of the two tectonic plates, and that the sediments there aren't as packed in as they thought, but rather fluid, so to speak. Kind of as if the high pressure water was acting like a lubricant between the two plates, allowing the Juan de Fuca plate to slide smoothly under the North American plate. So basically, the Cascadian subduction zone is leaking lubricant, and this is slowly increasing friction between the plates. Remember what I said about what happens when the two plates stick because of friction? The top plate buckles and then thrusts out when it unsticks, unleashing a mega thrust quake. So now you understand what all this is about. People feared that A, we're already overdue for the next megaquake, and B, the water seeping out of Pythia's oasis is only making things worse. People have been scared of this megaquake since the 80s, and they've even dubbed it the big one. We're talking about an earthquake of up to 9.2 on the Richter scale, even worse than the Tohoku quake in 2011, which was the most costly earthquake in the world's history, even though the Japanese are the best prepared in the world against earthquakes. So what will something like this do to Oregon? Dogs will start barking around 30 seconds before the seismic waves actually hit, because they can hear the high-pitched sound of rocks grinding against each other before the ground actually starts to move. The tremors will start softly and strengthen, lasting a terrifying 5.5 minutes. On the Northwest coast, we only started implementing seismic-proof construction code in the mid-90s. So over 1 million buildings are in danger of collapsing, including 2/3 of all hospitals and about 3,000 schools. A total of 75% of all buildings along with the Northwest coastline could be compromised by the quake alone. The immediate aftermath will be horrible, with fires, toxic chemical spills, and devastation all around. But people will have to gather whatever they can and run, because the worst is yet to come. A massive 600-mile-long tsunami will be on the way to finish the job. According to the FEMA Regional Director Kenneth Murphy, everything west of Interstate 5 will be destroyed, including Seattle, Portland, Eugene, Salem, Victoria, and even Vancouver. I live 10 miles from the Pacific Ocean here in San Diego, and San Diego is not on that list. I wonder if we're safe. Let me know in the comments what you think. After that, all utilities would be down. Hundreds to thousands to millions in the Northwest coast will be left without power, gas, or running water. And add insult to injury, in the past 3,000 years, major Cascadia quakes have caused San Andreas to rupture as well at least 9 times. This means that it's very likely that if Cascadia goes, so will San Andreas, unleashing another major earthquake in California and western Mexico as well. I gotta tell you, this is scary as hell. So the only thing I'm thinking about is what we can do about it. And I'll be honest, at first, I felt completely helpless. There's nothing, literally nothing we could do to prevent and even predict when this megathrust quake will hit. We're just sure that it's eventually going to. But I'm not the type to make a video for you guys just to get you worked up and worry that you might die tomorrow. It turns out there actually are plenty of things that we can do to prepare. Even if it's not a magnitude 9 quake, even a much milder 8.0 Richter scale earthquake could end up disrupting power, water, gas, and communication systems. Going off-grid is the perfect way to hedge against that risk, and that's why I focus and worry so much about it, particularly if you live on higher ground. If you live near the water, though, odds are it really wouldn't make that much of a difference. We've covered tons of stuff about how to go off-grid using solar batteries and switching to induction cooktops, to atmospheric water harvesting, and all sorts of technologies. My good friend Matt Farrell is also doing an entire series on his channel on Undecided. Another tip, solar plus Starlink or whichever other satellite internet company is going strong where you live would be another great way to stay on top of what's going on with the news in the middle of the chaos. Living in California, where almost all buildings are built to withstand earthquakes, this one came as a surprise to me. If you live in the Northwest and your house is over 30 years old, odds are it won't take the beating from the earthquake like the big one. But you can actually fix this. To prevent your home from collapsing or sliding off a foundation, you can retrofit it with seismic upgrades, such as bolting it onto the foundation, bracing the walls and chimney, reinforcing the roof and windows, and installing flexible pipes and valves for gas and water lines. You can also secure your furniture and appliances to the wall or floor with straps or braces, and remove any heavy or sharp objects that could fall or fly during an earthquake. There are actually plenty of companies out there that do this sort of work, like NW Seismic, a family-owned business in Portland, Earthquake Tech, and Secure Seismic. But I bet you're thinking that's gotta be expensive. But it's actually not as bad as you might think. Prices vary significantly, but the average is about $2 to $5 per square foot. In Oregon, the average size of a family home is around 2,200 square feet, so that means it could cost between $4,000 to $11,000 to retrofit your home. And the best part is that there are grants and loans available from the government of Oregon for people who can't afford the added expenses straight up. I'll leave a link in the description where you can get more information. Just like single-family homes, bigger buildings like schools and hospitals and other infrastructure can also be retrofitted for earthquakes and also for tsunamis, so waves and debris don't take the entire building down. In addition to making your home more earthquake resistant, you should also have an emergency plan and kit ready for yourself and your family. Your plan should include where to meet, how to contact each other, and what to do in the case of an evacuation or a tsunami warning. We've all been taught at school that when an earthquake hits, we should duck, cover, and hold. But that may not always be the best course of action, according to seismologists. It all depends on where you are when the earthquake first starts. If you're at home or in a safely reinforced building, is probably the best place to be until the shaking stops. But if you're in an old, unreinforced masonry building from before the 90s, that building is almost sure to collapse. And if you're near the exit, it may be best to just run outside as soon as the minor tremors start. But honestly, we're not here to give advice on this stuff. Definitely consult the experts on what you should do. Earthquakes form two types of waves. The primary pressure waves, or P waves, are milder, but travel faster than the secondary shear waves, or S waves, which are the most destructive. So the P wave is like a warning of what's to come. P waves travel an average of 3.4 miles per second, actually really fast, and S waves about 2.2 miles per second. So if the earthquake forms at about 50 miles off the coast, it'll take about 40 seconds for the second wave to hit after the first one. So you can do a lot in 40 seconds, like get out of a building that you know could collapse. All that said, there may be a silver lining to this story. Yes, lubricant is leaking out of the subduction zone, which is definitely bad. But one thing news outlets neglected to mention was that this hole and others like it may have been gushing water for the last 1,500 years, give or take. So we're talking about something that has been there throughout the last six Cascadian quakes, including the last big one in 1700. So the fact that we've discovered it now really doesn't mean anything in terms of the risk of an earthquake, any more than discovering how the weather works increases the chance of a storm. On the other hand, the mere fact that we discovered the tectonic lubricant was seeping actually shows us that there was any lubricant between the plates to begin with. And I'm no seismologist, but I'm guessing that means the plates aren't stuck together, but just sliding along. And sliding means no energy buildup and no massive megathrust quake, at least not in the short term. Of course, news media do love to create a bit of panic and drama around everything, and these mega disasters are just such low-hanging fruit. Philip and his team dubbed the hole in the Pacific Pythia's Oasis in reference to the famous Oracle of Delphi, who went into a trance by inhaling fumes emanating from the fissures in the earth underneath the Temple of Apollo. So, fissures in the ground, things pouring out, looks kind of blurry. Kind of makes sense, right? But it's the part about Pythia being an oracle that's the most unsettling for me, considering that the paper on Pythia's Oasis stirred up a revival of the prophesized big quake that is long overdue in North America's Northwest, something Philip and his crew had no way of knowing at the time. Coincidence? A hunch? I'll let you be the judge of that. And if you thought that was insane, you gotta watch this video on the supervolcano lingering underneath Yellowstone next.